now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
Well, we're going to have a lot of comedy this weekend, a lot to laugh about here on Classic Radio Theater. We'll start off today's show with George Burns and Gracie Allen. Harold Peary is the Great Gildersleeve. Jack Benny in an episode of the Hallmark Playhouse called My Financial Career. The Milton Berle Show and a salute to the opera. And an episode of Lum and Abner. That's all straight ahead. Tomorrow, by the way, we will have a Jack Benny Thanksgiving show. Phil Harris and Alice Spey, Amos and Andy, the Old Gold Comedy Theater, and an episode of Claudia. That's coming up tomorrow. But right now, we thank you for tuning in on this Saturday, 18th day of November, 322nd day of the year, 43 days left till we get to 2024. According to legend, William Tell shot an apple off his son's head on this date in 1307. Christopher Columbus first sighted what is now Puerto Rico in 1493. Mark Twain's story, The Celebrated Jumping Frog of Calaveras County, published in the New York Saturday Press in 1865. A lot of that also came back in the Jack Benny Show in later years. He had one of his characters coming out of Calaveras County. In 1883, American and Canadian railroads instituted 5 standard continental time zones, ending the confusion of thousands of local time zones. In 1903, the Hay-Bunau-Varilla Treaty, signed by the U.S. and Panama, giving Americans exclusive rights over the Panama Canal Zone. Release of the animated short Steamboat Willie, the first fully synchronized sound cartoon on this date in 1928. Keep an eye open. Disney will work its way out of the Mickey Mouse business now that the character is going to go out of copyright. Directed by Walt Disney and Oobworks, the second appearances of cartoon stars Mickey and Minnie Mouse on this date in 1928. 1938, trade union members elected John L. Lewis as the first president of the Congress of International Organizations.
We're afraid to go to war. Afraid of what? Afraid of the arrogant and the insolent economic, political, and financial power of this group of Southern operators and the communities that they rule. Afraid of what? Afraid to desert 145,000 men who are members of this union and leave them to the tender mercies of these arrogant and insolent gentlemen who do not hesitate to suborn public officials in their communities, to police their communities with privately hired and armed gunmen, to evict our people from their homes, so that they'll have no domicile, they have none except those owned by the company, and to close their commissaries and company stores, to cut off food supplies for our people and leave them to their mercy, to cut off water and electric light, and to cut off medical attention. Because they own. Yes, I'm wondering, Senator, where the war is today. And apparently, we have plenty of aid to give stricken peoples anywhere in the world except in the mining regions of this country.
John L. Lewis, who would head the United Mine Workers from 1920 until 1960. 1959, William Wyler's film Ben-Hur premiered at Lowe's Theater in New York City. President Nixon asked Congress on this date in 1970 for $155 million in supplemental aid for the Cambodian government in the middle, of course, the Vietnam War. In Guyana, on this date in 1978, Jim Jones led his People's Temple cult in a mass murder-suicide that claimed 918 lives in all.
Please, for God's sake, let's get on with it. We've lived as no other people lived and loved. We've had as much of this world as you're going to get. Let's just be done with it. Let's be done with the agony of it. This is a revolutionary suicide. It is not a self-destructive suicide. So they'll pay for this. They brought this upon us. And they'll pay for that.
A recording of Jim Jones at the People's Temple cult. 909 people died at the Jonestown Temple itself, including over 270 children, and Congressman Leo Ryan of California. 918 people died on this date in 1978. In 1978, also, the Blues Brothers appeared for the first time on Saturday Night Live. 1982, Duck Koo Kim. Died unexpectedly from injuries sustained during a 14-round boxing match against Ray Mancini in Las Vegas. It prompted reforms in the sport of boxing. 1985, Calvin and Hobbes, a comic strip by Bill Watterson, first published. It would leave syndication in 1995. Washington Redskins quarterback Joe Theismann broke his leg on this date in 1985, ending his career. In 1987, the Congress issued its final report on the Iran-Contra affair. In 1988, President Reagan signed a bill into law providing the death penalty for murderous drug traffickers. In 1991, Shiite Muslim kidnappers in Lebanon set Anglican Church envoys Terry Waite and Thomas Sutherland free. In 1999, College Station, Texas, 12 killed, 27 injured at Texas A&M University. No, not a mass shooting. A huge bonfire under construction collapsed. Also on this date in 1999 in Jasper, Texas, 24-year-old Sean Allen Berry sentenced to life in prison, becoming the third person convicted in the racially motivated death of James Byrd Jr. In 2001, the Nintendo GameCube released, and I know people swear by the GameCube still to this day, over 20 years later. 2002, the state of New Jersey banned the game dodgeball from public schools. 2003, the Massachusetts Supreme Court ruled 4-3 in Goodrich versus Department of Public Health that the state's ban on same-sex marriage was unconstitutional. 2005, Robert Blake found liable for the wrongful death of his wife in a civil trial. Jury ordered him to pay $30 million. Actor Tom Cruise and actress Katie Holmes married in Italy on this date in 2006. They would be divorced 6 years later. 2 days before turning 92, Senator Robert C. Byrd, the Democrat from West Virginia, became the longest-serving lawmaker in congressional history at 56 years, 320 days. He would serve until his death in 2010. His record would be surpassed by Michigan Congressman John Dingell. And in 2020, a weird story, the Utah monolith, built sometime in 2006, discovered by state biologists of the Utah Division of Wildlife Resources, 4 years after it was built. Well, following intense media coverage, it was covertly removed on November 27, 2020 by four residents of Moab, Utah. After nearly a month in their possession, it was given to the Bureau of Land Management, currently in their custody. Its origin still remains unknown. Among those passing away on this date in history, President 21, Chester A. Arthur. Also, Vice President Henry A. Wallace. Band leader Cab Calloway. Actor James Coburn. Pianist composer Cy Coleman. And a character actor Harold J. Stone. Did a lot of heavy roles.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcements. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
Those who are no longer with us include conductor Eugene Ormandy, pollster George Gallup, actress Imogene Coca, very, very funny lady, lyricist Johnny Mercer, astronaut Alan Shepard, and Hank Ballard.
1960. Hey now, hey now, hey now, it's finger pop, popping time. Real good sign.
It got up to number 2 on the rhythm and blues charts, number 7 on the pop charts in 1960. Hank Ballard and the Midnighters, Finger Poppin' Time. It was nominated for an R&B Grammy Award in 1961. It lost to Ray Charles. If you're going to lose to somebody, Ray Charles is a good guy to lose to, you know. Hank Ballard and the Midnighters. Hank Ballard, born on this date in history. Turning 84 years old today, fine actress Brenda Vaccaro. From Big Valley and Dynasty, Linda Evans turns 81. From Simon and Simon, Jameson Barr Parker. He played Simon. No, the other Simon. 76 years old today. Mr. Belding from Saved by the Bell. Dennis Haskins is 73. From Saturday Night Live, Kevin Nealand is 70. The lady who redid the Supreme song, You Keep Me Hanging On, Kim Wilde, 63 today. Owen Wilson is 55. A trio turned 53 today. La Femme Nikita, Peta Wilson, Mike Epps from Next Friday in The Hangover, and Megyn Kelly. All three turned 53 today. From American Psycho and Big Love, Chloe Sevigny is 49. NASCAR's Denny Hamlin is 43. And the offspring of Damon Wayans, ironically named Damon Wayans Jr. He was in Big Hero 6 and Happy Enough. Damon Wayans Jr., 41. Those just a few of the people who celebrate the 18th day of November as their birthday, and this happens to be your birthday.
Hi, we're the Four Freshmen, and we just want to say, Happy Birthday to you.
I'm sitting here sipping on a Dr. Pepper, and why I bring that up is I recorded 2 shows today, and the first show, I just wasn't there. And I got me a Dr. Pepper, and now, after having just a little bit of it, the caffeine has got me going. People say, why do you drink that horrible stuff? If you're going to get me something, get me a Dr. Pepper. Down in Waco, Texas, there is a plant there that still bottles Dr. Pepper with cane sugar, which is much better for you than the high fructose corn syrup and the other stuff. Sweet tea, I enjoy that. But I have to drink a lot of sweet tea for that to kick in. And coffee and I just never have gotten along. Okay, enough of that. Let's go back to 83 years, November 18th, 1940. George Burns and Gracie Allen. That's next. And I think it's Maxwell House coffee time. Oh, boy. And I've sit here and dunked on coffee. You're listening to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. But first...
Ladies and gentlemen, make tomorrow your D-Day. Get an extra bond for defense. Step into any bank or post office and buy yourself a profitable share in America's future. As an investment, bonds are better than ever. They can help you save safely, conveniently, and profitably. So whether you already buy on the payroll savings plan where you work or the bond-a-month plan where you bank, get an extra bond for defense tomorrow.
And at least he didn't talk about any secret words. Now, let's get started here with an episode of George Burns and Gracie Allen. As we're coming up, a week away from Thanksgiving? Is that right? Yeah, Thanksgiving is next Thursday. And here we've got an episode from 83 years ago, November 18th, 1940. And I talk about how my focus was better. The Thanksgiving show from George Burns and Gracie Allen.
From Hollywood, the George Burns and Gracie Allen Show for Hormel and Spam.
Crazy people. Spam, rebuff, boom, spam. George Burns and Gracie Allen. On the show where there's orchestra. The singing glee with a smoothie street. Last but not least, and with Bud Heaston.
quiz question, friends, and it'll pay you to know the answer. Ready for the question? All right. What is an easy way to serve the family a swell main course for dinner that costs but a few cents? There's no magic about it. Just open a can of Spam, S-P-A-M, and bake according to the simple directions on the label. Takes only a jiffy, and you'll set before the family a delicious taste surprise that satisfies even the huskiest appetite. That's because Spam is grand-tasting meat, and baked, it certainly makes a hit. The perfect combination of juicy pork shoulder and ham meat, originated by Hormel, gives Spam extra flavor, extra goodness. Try a Spam bake for dinner tomorrow. Just be sure you ask your food dealer for S-P-A-M Spam. And here they are, the stars of our big happy family, George and Gracie.
Thank you very, very much. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen...
Oh, George, where's Gracie?
She's not here. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen...
George, can you do a show without Gracie?
Certainly I can do a show without her. Do you think I need Gracie?
Certainly, Bud. He needs Gracie about as much as Dorothy L'Amour needs a sarong.
Yeah. Oh, yeah? Well, listen, I happen to have a lot of talent and... Well, I'll answer you later. Hello?
This is Spam's Meatball, Gracie Allen speaking.
Gracie, where are you? We're doing a broadcast, and you're supposed to be here.
I couldn't get down on account of my granddaddy's very sick. He was on the floor all last night, and we're awfully worried.
He was on the floor?
Yes.
What about the bed?
Well, we couldn't use that. We had a party here last night. Where could we put the hats and coats?
Well, Gracie, where's your granddaddy now?
He's down in the kitchen with a temperature of 105, and we're awfully
worried. He has a temperature of 105?
Yes, and we're...
Well, why have you got him in the kitchen?
Well, he's defrosting the icebox.
Your granddaddy's in the Frigidaire?
For 7 hours.
Well, aren't you afraid he'll freeze?
Oh, that's impossible. Every hour we open the Frigidaire and ask him if he's cold. He doesn't answer.
Look, Gracie, we're doing a broadcast.
Really? What station? I must listen in.
Well, never mind. That's a smart idea, putting a man with a temperature in a Frigidaire. I suppose to cure him, they'll put an ice pack on his head and a hot water bottle on his feet.
Oh, George, all they need to use is a can of Spam.
Can of Spam?
Sure, cold or hot, it hits
the spot. Oh, yes, but... You're a regular Dr. Kildare. Look, everybody, not that I need Gracie, but I think we ought to go over to Gracie's house and do the broadcast. Might make an old man happy.
Well, if it's going to make you happy, George, let's go.
Oh. Quiet.
Bueno, podemos hacer una cosa. Yo tengo un carro nuevo.
Well,
si quieren, yo
back again,
puedo
folks.
Llevar.
Yes,
allá.
Guitar player, I know. What is it, Senor Lee?
Why don't you drive down in my car? I just got a brand new rooster.
A rooster?
Sí, señor. A car made by General Mothers.
It's not General Mothers, it's General Motors.
Oh.
A mother is, well, for example, when you were a baby, who combed your hair?
That's what I'd like to know. The part isn't straight.
Well, quiet. Come on, everybody. We got to get to Gracie's house. Oh, well. Here we are at Gracie's house. I'll ring the doorbell.
George, you better knock on the door. The bell doesn't work.
Well, this is the house, all right.
Oh, hello, George. When did you get here?
Well, I give up.
Hello, everybody.
Hello. Gracie, do you know that you're not all there?
I know. I just had my tonsils removed.
Tonsils removed? That annoys me. That's all I've got.
Say, Gracie, what's the matter with your granddaddy?
Oh, he doesn't take care of himself. He inhales cigars.
Well, what's wrong with him?
Well, most people just inhale the smoke.
Look, Gracie, you'll have to excuse me if I run away just before the broadcast is over. You see, I've got a date with a little redhead, and she won't wait.
Well.
A redhead? Say, Poopsie, how do you get all these gals?
Well, why shouldn't he? George is a good dancer, he's a swell dresser, he's romantic, spends lots of money. Continue on next page.
Artie, don't read that part.
Well, come on, everybody.
Say,
right,
Gracie,
through this long...
Gracie, what is this? You've got barbed wire on the banisters?
Well, you know, my granddaddy likes to slide down the banisters.
Oh, I see, and that stops him.
No, it doesn't stop him, but it slows him down a bit.
I think I know what you mean. It is.
It isn't.
It is.
It isn't.
It is.
No, it isn't. It...
Who are they?
Oh, they've been living here for over a year.
Well, who are they?
I don't know.
Chrissy, you know, this house is filled with imbeciles.
Well, I better tell Granddaddy you're all here.
Well, never mind that. We better start the broadcast.
What's tonight's program about, George?
It's about Thanksgiving.
What's that?
What's that? Look, Gracie, as far back as you can remember, what always happened in November?
Roosevelt was elected.
Well, I'll try to explain it to you.
All right.
You see, in 1620, the first Americans arrived in a new land to make a fresh start.
Uh-huh.
They decided to build homes. And do you know one of the first things they did?
They applied for FHA loans.
FHA loans didn't come until 300 years later.
Well, you've got to go through a lot of red tape before you get the money.
Anyway, these people were called Puritans.
What's that?
What's that? Did you ever read of those people who suffered and were punished in stocks?
Oh, in 1929, some of my best friends were Puritans.
Well, anyway, these people were so grateful for finding a freedom in a new country that they killed a turkey and called it Thanksgiving.
Oh, what a cute name for a turkey.
And the custom still remains. Even today, we chop the heads off turkeys.
How can you knock off all their heads at once?
A turkey only has one head.
Then where do all the necks come from? Last year, my sister got a neck, my brother got a neck, my uncle got a neck.
Oh, well, this is the end.
That's the part my daddy got.
Look, Smoothies, Babs, Charlie, and Little, will you sing a song while I try to explain to Gracie what Thanksgiving is? Please.
In a dinky honky tonky village in Texas, there's a guy who plays the best piano by far. He can play a piano any way that you like it, but the style he likes the best is ain't to no bar. When he plays just no bar, he's the daddy of them all. The people gather around when he gets on stand, and when he plays, he gets a hand. The rhythm he beats puts the cats in a trance. Nobody's there while the two dance, but when he jams with the bass and guitar, they holler, he's me daddy.
Never seen a house like this. People walking around and nobody knowing them. And this furniture. What kind of furniture is this?
Well, it comes from the Hollywood Furniture Company.
Yeah, but what about the period?
Oh, pardon me. It comes from the Hollywood Furniture Company, period.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Oh, say, Gracie, where's your kitchen? I want to get a sandwich.
Oh, Bud, we haven't got any Spam in the Frigidaire.
No Spam in the Frigidaire?
Not in the Frigidaire. Spam doesn't need any refrigeration.
Oh, shucks. I forgot. I'll hate myself in the morning.
Oh! Oh! No! Oh!
What's that?
That's my granddaddy. He's sliding down the banister.
He's sliding down a barbed wire banister?
Well, he does it 20 times a day, and the doctor told him to stop.
Well, I imagine he would.
Sure. Bad for his heart.
Well, I hope the kid makes a three-point landing.
It is.
It isn't?
It is.
It isn't.
It is.
It isn't.
Gracie, these fellas have been living in your house for over a year and you don't know who they are?
That's right.
Well, why don't you ask them?
I don't talk to strangers.
Well, this is some house.
George, I better go and find Granddaddy and give him his medicine. You see, he hasn't got a nurse anymore.
Oh, he had a nurse, huh?
Yes. And the only way he'd take his medicine was when the nurse would kiss him after every teaspoonful. It was awful stuff.
Bitter, huh?
No, he hasn't any teeth.
Well, let's get this over with. All right, let's find your granddaddy and give him this medicine. Boy, what a house. I've never seen... Hey, sound man. 4 years in Harvard. Why are you sitting out in the hall all by yourself, sulking?
A big Harvard-Yale game this year, and I won't be there.
Well, why don't you go?
Not after the sad experience I had last year. There I was at the stadium. It was the last quarter. The score was nothing to nothing. Just as Yale was making a touchdown, somebody stuck a gun in my back and held me up.
Well, there were millions of people there. Why didn't you yell?
What? And have them think I was rooting for Yale?
Well, come on, Gracie.
Hey, George. George. When you meet this little red-headed girl tonight, why don't you take her to the Follies Bergère? It's a swell show.
Ah, those girly shows are all the same, Artie. Take away their feathers and their little umbrellas and what have you got?
High blood pressure.
Oh, quiet.
Well, here's Granddaddy's room.
Well, look, Gracie, before we all go in, what's the matter with your granddaddy?
Well, we really don't know. In the middle of the night, we heard strange noises and we ran into Granddaddy's room and there he was shaking all over.
He was shaking all over?
Yes.
Well, what did you do?
What did we do? We sent for a doctor.
Well, what did the doctor do?
Well, he took the Madame Lazanga record off the troll and we all went back to sleep again.
Kid has probably got lumbatism.
Hiya, Grace.
Hiya, Grandpa.
Well, what's the matter, Grandpa? Don't you feel well?
No, Georgie boy. Say, hand me that picture of Hedy Lamarr on a sleeping tablet.
Well, I can't find Hedy Lamarr's picture. Do you want this one of Ann Sheridan?
No, I'm saving her until I feel better. Yahoo!
Well, wait, Grandpa. I'll look in this closet.
It is.
It isn't.
It is.
It isn't.
I can't say this. Gracie, can somebody else in your family give him the medicine? I've got a date with that little redhead.
Well, my mother's at her sewing club, and my daddy went downtown to vote, and my
your
brother...
Your daddy went downtown to vote?
Yes, and my brother...
The election was over 2 weeks ago.
I know, but my daddy's a Republican, and he never gives up.
Listen, Gracie, try to understand this. I've got a date with a girl.
Senor Burns,
I can't stand this.
Senor Burns, look out. Don't get excited. You'll break a blood weasel.
Well, don't worry about me. And besides, you said that wrong.
Oh, pardon me. Don't get excited. You'll break a blood weasel.
Well, that's much better.
Say, buddy boy.
What is it, Granddaddy?
Buddy boy, would you mind reaching in that coat pocket and getting me a cigar?
Oh, what coat, Grandpa?
The one George is wearing.
There aren't any cigars in my pocket.
You mean you didn't get anything with that suit?
That was a pretty good one, Corny.
Oh, quiet. Even if I did have a cigar, if I did get a cigar with it, why should I give it to you? You're the tightest old man I ever met. You never gave anybody anything.
Oh, Judge, you shouldn't say that to my granddaddy when he's so sick. He gave you something.
When did he ever give me something?
Tonight.
What did he give me?
The measles.
The measles?
Now, Artie Shaw, his clarinet, and his boys will give us Sugar.
Thank you.
know that. I know that, Gracie. But if your granddaddy had the measles, he shouldn't have kept it a secret.
He didn't. He's been spreading it all around.
Why do they ever go into this crazy house? What's that?
She's practicing up in the attic.
Who's practicing?
My grandmother.
Your grandmother? Gracie, will you tell your grandmother to stop? We can't continue talking if she's going to make all that noise upstairs. Why, this is the craziest house. Listen to that. Beat, 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 beat.
Meat, eat, eat, meat. I say there, lady, when a shopping you go, here's some news that you should know. Help me out, George. I've gone this far.
I'll beat it out, bud. A to the bar. Spam is the meat that you should buy. Spam is different, and here is why.
We use pork shoulder to make Spam sweet, and the ham it takes for extra good meat.
The extra good flavor that you get in Spam got there, folks, because we added ham.
Hormel started this new kind of meat, seasoned it better, made it grand to eat.
I say, Senor Burns, serve Spam for lunch. This delicious meat is good to crunch.
Look, Senor Lee, it's crunch, not crunch.
Crunch, crunch.
Crunch, crunch.
You buy it all the time if you try it lunch.
To get the real thing to put on your table, look for this sentence on the Spam can label.
Pork shoulder meat with ham meat added. Proof that Spam is really different. My, 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 that doesn't fit.
Yeah, that's right, Gracie. That's the worst one yet.
Nothing is just like Spam, my friend.
And so with this, our poem ends. When a shopping you'd go tomorrow, ma'am,
ask for S-P-A-M Spam.
Slice it, dice it, fry it, bake it, cold or hot, Spam hits the spot.
Look, George, if there's a possibility of your having the measles, I wouldn't keep that date with that redhead.
Well, don't worry about me, Artie. I'm going out right now and get myself inoculated.
Well, why do it tonight? Why don't you wait until New Year's Eve?
Look, Gracie, inoculation prevents sickness. You see, millions of germs can live on the head of a pin.
How can they eat that stuff?
They use a knife and fork.
Oh!
Well, I'm going to get out of this house before it's too late.
There, mister. Where do you think you're going?
I'm going out, officer. Why?
Oh, no, you're not. Nobody leaves this house. It's quarantined.
But I'm George Burns. I haven't got anything.
I've heard you on the air, brother, and you ain't kidding.
Let me tell you something.
Get back in there.
Well, this is a fine thing. And I've got myself...
Oh, look who's here. Hello, George. Are you back from your date already? Did you meet that girl? Did you kiss her?
Gracie, I was stopped by a cop.
Oh, that's what always happens in those parked cars.
I knew you'd understand me.
Once I was in a parked car with the freshest fella, and you know what he said to me?
Will you be reasonable?
That's what he said to me.
Oh, stop.
That's what I said to him.
Gracie, I didn't even get out of the door. There's a cop outside. He says your house is quarantined.
He's crazy. It's Ducko.
Well, never mind. I'll see you later. I've got to keep this date. I wonder where this door leads to. Oh, wrong door. Isn't that silly? The broom closet.
Oh, look who's here. Hello, George. When did you get back? Did you have a nice time with the redhead?
Gracie, I was in the broom closet.
Oh, her husband came home, huh?
Look, I'm trying to get out of this house of yours.
Well, I've got an idea. Let's do what they do in the movies. Now, I'll tie this bed sheet around you and let you out of the window.
Say, that's not a bad idea. Here, put it on me right
here. Oh, then I'll tie this end to the bed. All right. All ready, George. Climb out of the window.
Well, here I go. Ouch! Gracie! Gracie!
What?
What part of the bed did you tie it to?
The pillow!
The pillow?
Hey, you Burns, I told you the place was quarantined. Now get back in that house.
Oh. Hmm.
Well, look who's here. Hello, George. Are you back from the date already? Did you have a nice time for the redhead?
See, I almost killed myself. I just went through that window.
Oh, her husband came home again, huh?
You know, you could use another ounce of brain.
Not me. I'm overweight now.
matter where I go, that copper's there. I wish he'd stick to his beat.
Stick to his what?
Beat. Beat.
Meat. Meat. Spam is the meat that
you should
eat.
Spam is, I know that. I know. You should try. I know that, but we've done it before. This poetry is going from bad to verse.
Oh.
It's just a little slip. Look at me. I'm filthy. How can I get washed up?
Just keep on telling those jokes, brother.
Gracie, where's the washroom?
Right down the hall. You can't miss it. It's the one with the gasoline pump in front of it.
Gasoline pump?
Sure. My grandmother's a tourist, and we like to make her feel at home.
Well, I'll go in there and get cleaned up. It is.
It isn't.
It is.
It isn't.
It is. Wait a minute. All you guys have been doing is arguing. What are you arguing about?
I claim this Thursday is the real Thanksgiving, and Joe says it isn't.
Well, it is.
It is.
It is.
Oh, keep still. Gracie, I've got to get out of here.
Well, George, why don't you go up on the roof and slide down the drain peep, and then when you get to the yard...
The drain peep?
Yeah, when you get to the yard...
The drain peep?
Oh, pardon me, I was out with Senor Lee last night.
Oh. Keep on going out with him and you won't be able to speak English.
Senor Burns, when you say that, smile.
Smile?
Yes. S-M-E-L-L. Smile.
That smell.
You're perfect.
Oh, please, everything happens to me. Here, I've got a date with a girl. I'm all messed up. I scrape my nose. Huh. What a pickle.
Looks more like a banana.
Oh, yeah? Well, my face happens to be all right. Doesn't bother me.
Maybe that's on account of your standing behind it.
Yeah, maybe. Well, I've just got to get out of here.
Mr. Burns.
What does it sound, man?
Just look at this goldfish bowl. It's a rhapsody in glass. It's made of pure quartz silicate.
Time like this, he's got to impress me with his education. There must be some way out.
Say, sound man, what happened to the goldfish that were in that bowl? Answer me, what did you do with those goldfish?
Forgive me, Miss Ellen, I couldn't help it. Once a Harvard man, always a Harvard man.
Well, there must be some way out of here.
Say, sound man, I don't mind your eating the goldfish, but Tom Harmon is going to get pretty angry.
Why, Tom Harmon is that great Michigan football player.
Well, it's also the name of our cat.
You call your cat Tom Harmon?
Well, yeah, that's on account of every time he gets loose, he makes 10 yards.
Hey, wait a minute. Why didn't I think of this before? Gracie, where's the chimney?
Right there.
Well, goodbye, everybody. Goodbye. I'm going up the chimney.
What a guy will go through for a woman.
Well, here it is. I'm out. There's the blue sky.
Blue sky, nothing. That's my uniform, you see. Get back in there.
Oh! Oh! Oh!
Look who's here. Hello, George. You're back.
Quiet, quiet, quiet!
Until then, this is Bud Heaston reminding you to remember that cold or hot, Spam hits the spot. Have you tried Hormel Chili Con Carne? Even those who think they don't like chili do like Chili Con Carne the way Hormel makes it because it's different and everybody likes it. Double your money back if you don't like it. Try Hormel Chili Con Carne tomorrow. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Sprint to the finish for George and Gracie 83 years ago, November 18th, 1940. This is Classic Radio Theater. Coming up next, we'll head to Summerfield and see what's going on with the Water Commissioner, the Great Gildersleeve.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the next 7 years of bigger and bigger enrollments, America's grade schools will need nearly 250,000 extra teachers besides those to fill normal vacancies. This great need, plus the growing public interest in education and improvements in schools, make elementary school teaching a more rewarding career than ever, a career that high school and college students should certainly consider. Education holds America's future, perhaps your future.
Fenneman's getting around a lot today, isn't he? We go to the Great Gildersleeve. We go from Spam to Kraft, and we see what's going on in the household of the Great Gildersleeve, starring Harold Peary, 78 years ago, November 18th, 1945.
The Kraft Foods Company presents the Great Gildersleeve.
Yes.
It's The Great Gildersleeve, starring Harold Peary, brought to you by the Kraft Foods Company, makers of parquet margarine, and a complete line of famous quality food products. Now let's peep into the world of Summerfield and see what goes on there. It's Thursday night, not Saturday, but a familiar commotion upstairs over Floyd Munson's barber shop leads us to conclude that the Jolly Boys Club is assembled there.
Let's get started, huh?
Let's have order, please, gentlemen.
Nobody wants order, Judge. We're trying to organize a poker game.
We have a request from a member, Gildy, for a brief business session.
What member? What business?
Yeah, we never do any business.
Floyd Munson has made the request, Chief, and I feel we should honor it. Mr. Munson, you something to bring to the attention of the club?
I'll say.
Address the chair, and you may have the floor.
Address the chair, and you may have. Who made him chairman anyway?
Please, Gildy.
Mr. Chairman, fellow members, I'll say what I gotta say, and you can take it from there. And I might say before I start, I'm sorry to have to bring this up at this time. The club rooms here belong to me. Of course, the bank's got a piece of it, but the building's in my name. And the wife's.
All right. What of it?
Order. Continue, Floyd.
Well, I've been letting the club use the place. Glad to have you, but something's come up. Day before yesterday, I had a chance to rent it.
Rent it? Who'd want to rent this dump?
Well, it was a young fella and a girl. Just married. What do they care where they live? Anyhow, they offered me $20 a month.
That's a lot of money for this place, Floyd.
Inflation, Chief. That's what it is.
Well, the OPA said it was okay. I figure I can't afford to turn it down.
You gotta turn it down. This is the Jolly Boys' headquarters. You can't rent it to any Tom, Dick, and Harry that wants to go on a honeymoon.
Well, I was talking it over with the wife last night, and I told her that. I said, Lovey, the fellas won't like it. The club's been a second home to them.
What did she say, Floyd?
Well, it's no use going into that. To her, $20 is $20, at least. But now if the club was to pay me rent, why, naturally, I'd be glad to have you fellas stay on.
Oh, so that's it. You call yourself a jolly boy, Floyd? You're a hold-up man, that's what you are.
If I may step from the chair for a moment. Gildersleeve, you're being ridiculous.
Get back in the chair.
Let's just look at this thing sensibly. We're asking Floyd to give up $20 a month so we can have a club room. Is that the way for jolly boys to treat each other?
Why, no, that's terrible.
That's all there is to it. We've got to reimburse Floyd for the use of the club room. I now resume the chair.
Old goat.
Do I hear a motion that we reimburse Floyd for the use of the club room? Won't someone make the motion?
I'd be willing to make it.
That's illegal and unconstitutional. Listen, fellas, there's only 5 members in this club. Do you realize we'd each have to pay $4 a month dues?
Many clubs charge even more.
Not for a drafty room with a kitchen table and a busted piano.
Oh, it ain't a bad piano. The Elks don't have no piano at all.
The Elks have 2 pool tables.
Sure, when they pay dues, they get something for it.
Well, if we had more members, the dues wouldn't have to be so high.
Say, you might have something there, Judge.
Don't be childish, Floyd. When you ask people to join a club, they expect to get something for their money.
Like a pool table. Couldn't you get hold of a pool table someplace, Floyd?
Pool tables cost a lot of money.
I know who's got a pool table. Maybe he'd be willing to join the club and let us have it. Then we could put on a real membership drive.
Well, who's got it?
Your friend and neighbor, Gildy, Rumson Bullard.
Has Bullard got a pool table? No fooling?
It sure would be nice to have a pool table right in your house. That's my idea of living.
Yeah, well, I don't know whether Bullard's got one or not. Have you seen it, Horace?
No, I assumed you had. Haven't you ever been in your rich neighbor's house, Gildy?
On numerous occasions, but I never saw any pool tables.
Well, a pool table's pretty tough to hide. Ain't like a day bed, you know.
No. He might have a billiard room in the basement.
A playroom, probably. Lots of people have playrooms down in the basement, right there with the furnace, I hear.
Well, why don't we look into it? You drop over there tomorrow, Gildy, and see if he wants to join. Then, ask him to lend us the pool table.
Why me?
It's for the Jolly Boys, Commissioner. Sounds like the only way we can hold the Jolly Boys together.
Well, if you put it that way, but I'm not very anxious to call on Rumson Bullard. He's never been particularly friendly.
That's probably because you never got to know him. Down underneath, he's probably a swell fella.
It's not easy to get to know rich people, Chief. They're always afraid you're going to get something out of them.
Like a pool table.
Well, I'll see what I can do. Now, for heaven's sake, let's get our minds off money and play a little poker.
Why don't you go see him tomorrow night, Gildy, and then come down here and report to us?
All right, all right.
Okay, everybody, Andy and Nickel, Deuces and One-Eyed Jacks are wild, and no cheating till you're down to your last dollar.
Howdy, Bullard. Remember me? Gildersleeve.
Oh, yes, yes. Come in, won't you?
Well, thank you. Can't stay. I have to get downtown, but I thought I might just pay a neighborly call.
I'm glad you did. Wife's gone to New York for a few days, so I'm all alone here. With Craig, that is.
Oh, yes, Craig. Remarkably attractive little boy, Craig.
Yes. He's gone to bed, I'm glad to say. Why don't we just come into the library, Gildersleeve, as long as there's only two of us?
Library? Fine. I've never seen it.
Just down the hall here.
Well, well. Books.
Yes, yes. I've accumulated a few volumes. Sit down. Have a cigar?
Thanks. But here, try one of mine. Three for a half.
No, no, no. I insist. I have these made up for me in Havana, if you like a mild cigar.
Say.
Light.
By George, that's a real cigar.
Yep. Yeah, it makes a nice smoke.
Gold tip.
Yes, indeed. Well, care to look at some of my first editions? Or perhaps you're more interested in fine printing, bindings, and that sort of thing. Are you a bibliophile?
Oh, you bet I am. I belong to the Book of the Month for several years.
Well, I've got a... Yes, I have a few nice items here. See, here, here's something, yes. Milton's Paradise Lost, hand set in London by Alfred Royce. Printed on vellum with red and gold initials and bound in full Morocco.
I've read it.
Of course. But to a lover of fine printing, now, just look at this page.
Oh? Page 24. Beautiful, just as clear.
They only printed 200 of these. They sold originally for $700 a copy.
Huh?
Yes, yes, but I was lucky. I picked it up at an auction in London for $560. I robbed them, didn't I?
Yes, like taking pennies from a kid's bank. fine lot of books you got here, all right.
Oh, I'd forgotten you'd never been in this room. Care to see some of the rest of the house?
Well, I gotta be getting on. By the way...
Yes?
Nothing.
Well, you don't have to go just yet. Let me show you around.
Well, for a minute.
And here is my gun room.
Oh, yes. Gun room? Mm.
Another of my hobbies. The really old pieces I keep in the glass case here. Now, see that big fellow there on the end? That's a Spanish blunderbuss from the 18th century. Hand-carved barrel.
Will it shoot?
Well, I hate to try it. Now, the gun on the right is an old flintlock musket. My pistols and rifles are over here.
Say, this is a regular arsenal. You're not expecting any,
No. But I dare say I could give a pretty good account of myself if necessary. Now, this is a Derringer. Early 19th century. devilish-looking little thing, isn't it?
Yes. Let's go back to the library.
Well, we'll go back to the library later. First, I want to show you the billiard room. You've got to see that.
Don't tell me you've got a billiard table.
Yes, yes, I say billiards is really a gentleman's game.
Well, I can't seem to get the hang of it. Ever play any pool?
No, I never cared for pool. Do you like it?
No, billiards is the game for me.
Well, drop over any evening you care to play.
Yeah, I might just do that. Who do you play with, generally?
Oh, no one in particular. I haven't played a great deal of billiards since I lived in London. I belong to a club in London where I got very fond of it.
Oh, is that so? Speaking of clubs, Mr. Bullard, I...
Yes?
Nothing.
Yes, London's a great place for clubs. Now, this was a place in German Street. Been standing right there in the same spot for over 200 years.
Oh, pretty exclusive district around there?
A lot of fine clubs. In this club, they had, six or eight billiard tables, several card rooms. Many's the afternoon I've seen £5,000 change hands in that card room.
See, that's a fortune.
Yes, yes, but they're such gentlemen, you could hardly tell who'd won and who'd lost. Of course, one afternoon, a fellow shot himself afterward.
Oh, a winner or a loser?
A loser, yes. Brilliant young fellow he was, but wild as the devil. Youngest son of a duke.
Oh, a duke, yeah. Must have been a terrible shock to his father.
Frightful. The whole club was in mourning for a week. Ah, but club life is a fine thing.
Oh, you bet.
Spirit of good sportsmanship.
Yes, sir.
The feeling of loyalty and companionship between real gentlemen.
Yes, yes.
Ah, I miss club life. I don't suppose there are any men's clubs here in Summerfield, are there, Gildersleeve? I say, are there any men's clubs here in Summerfield?
No, Mr. Bullard. There isn't a single one. Wait a minute, fellas. Wait a minute. I tried to ask him. I started several times to ask him, and then each time something would come up that I couldn't.
Well, of all the chicken-hearted fellas to send on a simple errand...
Watch out who you're calling chicken-hearted, you old goat.
Why, what's trouble? Couldn't you get him around to the subject?
Well, we got to the subject, all right. We talked about clubs for quite a while.
What a cinch. Just say, speaking of clubs, Mr. Bullard, there's a little spot where I and a few of my friends hang out. Like to have you drop around sometime.
It wouldn't have worked, Floyd.
Well, I'm blessed if I see why.
Why didn't you ask him, Commissioner?
Because he's too good for this crummy joint, that's why.
Well, I'll be darned.
What makes him think he's such a mutch? That's what I want to know.
Well, it's not his idea necessarily, Floyd. It's my opinion.
You mean you think he's too good for us?
If you put it that way, yes.
Mr. Gildersleeve.
Oh, shut up and listen for a minute. Bullard has a house full of first editions, fine bindings. He has a dog that costs $300. He has a gun collection that must be worth thousands. He's a fellow that's used to gracious living. He can't hang around a club like this. It wouldn't be right.
Is this Bullard too good to associate with a judge of the probate court? Judge Hooker's a pretty high-class fella.
Thank you, Floyd.
Chief of police, one of the highest jobs in this town, and a useful man to know.
Thank you.
And what's the matter with Peavy? Runs as nice a drugstore as you'd want to see.
And Floyd, he's got the only barber shop in the south end of town.
Yeah.
I know, fellas. You just don't understand. Bullard's been in high-class clubs in London with dukes and gentlemen.
You ask me, Gildy, this fellow's nothing but a big snob.
He is not. He's a mighty nice man to know.
If you ask me, our water commissioner's getting to be a snob himself.
Oh! Don't call me a snob, Floyd. You fellas wouldn't know how to treat a high-class fellow like Bullard anyway.
All right, go treat him then.
Yeah, go ahead. We don't need you around here.
Fellows, Mr. Gildersleeve's a jolly boy.
I'm not sure he is, Chief. Not if he considers himself and his friends too good for us. Go on, go play pool with Bullard.
All right, I will.
Can you imagine that? Just for a pool table.
It's not a pool table, it's a billiard table. Billiards is a gentleman's game.
The Great Gildersleeve will be back in just a moment.
Do you have a big Thanksgiving dinner at your house, Mr. Lang?
Indeed we do. Turkey with all the trimmings. And when Mrs. Lang planned her menu, I dropped a broad hint for some of those wonderful baking powder biscuits she serves on special occasions.
Well, we prefer Parker House rolls or muffins.
Well, it's a sure bet that hot breads of all kinds are popular on Thanksgiving menus. And, of course, everyone knows a delicious spread makes hot biscuits, rolls, and muffins taste extra good. That's why I always like to suggest that you serve them with parquet margarine.
Why, that's our favorite spread, Mr. Lang. We always use parquet margarine. My husband likes parquet better than any spread we've ever tried.
And I can well understand that, because parquet margarine's fresh, dairy-like flavor is still unmatched. So this week, when you're shopping for those good foods to serve during the Thanksgiving season, be sure to buy parquet margarine, the spread that tastes so good. That's P-A-R-K-A-Y. Delicious, economical parquet margarine, made by the Kraft Foods Company. I'm sure you'll like it, because millions prefer parquet margarine to any other brand. Now let's get back to our story. It's Saturday night, and Saturday night is the Jolly Boys' night to howl. But a voice is missing. For the first time in many weeks, Gildersleeve is not to be found with his old associates. Gildersleeve this evening has hurried through dinner, stuffed a pocket with expensive cigars, and set out to take advantage of Bullard's invitation to drop in anytime. Scarcely 24 hours have passed, and here he is, dropping in.
Oh. Hello, Craig. Is your father in?
Where's Leroy?
Leroy? Well, he's at home, I guess. Tell your father, will you, Craig, that Mr. Gildersleeve is here.
Craig, get away from that door. Come upstairs.
Who's that?
My nurse. She stinks.
Craig?
You'd better answer her, hadn't you?
Why should I? Where's Leroy? I want him to come over.
Well, Leroy can't just now, I'm afraid, Craig. Run up and tell your father he has a caller, will you?
Craig, shut that door and come up to bed.
There's a man here.
Yeah. Tell her it's Mr. Gildersleeve. It's Mr. Gildersleeve from across the street.
Well, there's nobody home.
Oh, well, Mr. Bullard will be back, maybe. I'll just amuse myself in the billiard room while...
There's nobody home.
Yes, you said that. He said I might use his billiard table anytime, so if you don't mind, perhaps...
He didn't say anything to me.
Guess he didn't. Fine way to treat a man. Invite him to use your billiard table, then sick the nurse on him. Oh, well. Now what'll I do? Saturday night. Only 7:30. Can't just go home and go to bed. Besides, it's Saturday night. No, I won't go down there. But what can I do? Yeah. Oh, you Saturday night. Here she comes. Boo! Surprise!
Oh, it's you.
Well, aren't you surprised to see me, Leela?
No. I suppose you'd be around sooner or later.
Oh, is that so? Well, get your things on, Leela. We're going places Saturday night.
I'm sorry. I have a previous engagement, which I'm just about to make.
But, Leela...
It's time you learn, Throckmorton. I have better things to do than sit here and wait for you to turn up. And it's time you learn there's more to courting a lady than just whistling at her.
She... Some Saturday night... Now, what am I going to do? What is there to do? Nope, I will not go down there. Suppose I could stroll down to the drugstore. See what's doing there. No, I'm always hanging around there. Won't go there either. Well, I guess all that leaves is home. What a town. Saturday night at home.
Unky, you back? I thought you were out for the evening.
Yes, well, I changed my mind, Marjorie. You going somewhere, my dear?
Over to Francie's. She has some of the gang coming in.
Oh, well, have a good time.
Thanks.
Oh.
Yes?
You wouldn't care to stay home and play a quiet game of dominoes or something with your old uncle, I suppose.
Unky, I'd love to. I'd just love to. But I promised Francie and the gang, and I wouldn't want to disappoint them. Ask me another time, will you?
Yes, yes. Run along. Have a good time.
Thanks.
Yes? Where's your brother? What's he doing?
Leroy? Oh, he's going to the movies if he hasn't already gone. Oh, here he comes now.
Yes. Well, Leroy, you're dressed up for once.
Yeah.
My boy, how would you like it if your old uncle went to the movies with you?
Well, I wasn't going to the movies exactly. Bertie was going to take me to hear Famous Jones and his orchestra at the Majestic. Hey, Bertie, it's 10 after.
I'm coming.
Now, wait a minute, my boy. I thought you and I might just stay home together tonight and have a good game of dominoes.
Are you kidding?
Come along, Leroy. Lock that front door and let's go out the back way.
Then if we stayed home tonight, why, next Saturday I'd take you to that football game you've been wanting so much to go to. How would that be?
Well,
Leroy, you coming?
Of course, it's up to you, my boy. You get your choice. The movies with Bertie this evening or the football game with me next Saturday. Makes no difference to me, one way or the other.
Well, if it makes no difference to you, Unc, I think I'll go with Bertie.
All right, go on then. Go on, all of you. Leave me alone here all by myself. I'm nobody. I just pay the bills around here, that's all.
Oh, hello, Mr. Gildersleeve.
Peavy.
Yeah, I've just about given you up for this evening.
I've just about given myself up.
How do you mean?
Peavy, have you ever tried spending an evening alone? Worst darn thing in the world.
Well, no, I wouldn't say that.
Well, it's terrible. That's why I came down here, to have somebody to talk to.
Well, as a matter of fact, I was planning to close up here a little early so that I could stop by the Jolly Boys Club on the way home.
Oh. Well, in that case...
How does it happen you're not over there this evening, Mr. Gildersleeve? You always seemed pretty faithful.
I couldn't make it.
Oh. Well, if you'd care to stop by there with me now...
Yeah, I think I'd better not, thanks.
Well, suit yourself, but you said you wanted somebody to talk to.
Well, truth of it is, Peavy, I've had a little falling out over there with some of the less desirable element.
Talking about Floyd?
Well, him and some others.
Chief Gates?
Him, too.
Hooker?
Uh-huh.
That leaves you and me. Well, these little differences of opinion are bound to occur, I'd say, even among jolly boys.
It was more than a difference of opinion, Peavy. Floyd called me a big, fat snob. There's no difference of opinion about that. Well, is there?
What did you call Floyd, Mr. Gildersleeve?
I didn't call him a thing. Not a thing.
You gave him no provocation?
None whatever.
He just walked in and said, "Hello, Mr. Gildersleeve, you big fat snob, huh?"
Well, I may have made some trifling reference to his social standing.
That's what I say. Now, why not let bygones be bygones? I'm sure if you come over there with me now and everybody apologizes...
That's one thing I'll never do, apologize.
All right, don't. Just come over there with me.
Let him come over here.
I'm closing up here.
Well...
You just come along and leave everything to me, Mr. Gildersleeve, and I'll see if I can't straighten it all out.
Well, all right, Peavy. But remember, I won't apologize.
Well, aren't you coming up, Mr. Gildersleeve?
I'll wait down here.
What for?
You go up and see how the land lies, Peavy. That's a good fella. I'll wait down here.
Yeah.
Call me if it's all right.
Well, if it ain't me.
Welcome, stranger.
Evening, my friend.
Oh, yes.
I suppose they're hashing me over up there now. I don't know that I like this. What are they taking so darn long about? Can't keep me waiting down here like a lackey. Wonder what a lackey is. Got a good mind to walk out and leave him flat. After all, I didn't want to come over here in the first place. This has been about long enough, by George. Gosh, you don't think they'd blackball me?
Commissioner! You down there, pal?
I hear you calling me.
Come ahead, the coast is clear.
You called me when the moon had veiled her light. Before I went from you into the night, I came, do you remember? Hi, fellas.
Evening, Throckmorton.
Lloyd? Hi. Hi.
Come in, Commissioner. Join the happy throng.
Thank you, Chief.
Now, we've been talking it over here, Commissioner. The pros and the cons. Floyd has got something he wants to say to you. Go ahead, Floyd. Say it.
Yes, Floyd. Say it.
Well, Commissioner, I'm sorry if I got a little out of line here the other night. The fact is, I didn't say what Peavy says I said.
I only told him what you told me.
You said, Floyd, that I was a big, fat snob.
I never said you were fat. Everybody knows that.
Floyd.
I didn't come down here, gentlemen, to be re-insulted.
Floyd, now apologize nice, like you said you would.
Go ahead, Floyd.
I'm sorry, Commissioner. I don't know what come over me. I could bite my tongue off. Well, ain't that good enough?
I think that's very handsome, Floyd. Commissioner?
Well, maybe it was my fault a little too, Floyd, now that I come to think of it.
You old swindler.
You old horse thief.
Oh, that's the stuff. My golly, it does my heart good to hear you talk like that. What say we shake hands all around, eh?
I'm game.
Shake, Gildy.
Shake, shake.
There is a tavern in the town,
and there my true love sets him down, and drinks his wine with laughter free, and never, never thinks of me,
oh, thinks of me.
From the Great Gildersleeve again in just a few moments. During the Thanksgiving and holiday season, there's usually a little strain on the family food budget. So on your shopping trips now, I imagine most of you ladies have an eye out for the best values in food. And when it comes to spreads for bread, one of the best values I know of is delicious parquet margarine. Parquet is only about half the price of costly spreads, and it provides your family with such rich, wholesome nourishment. Parquet is one of the best energy foods you can serve, and it's fortified with important vitamin A. And as for flavor, parquet is preferred by millions because it tastes so good on bread, toast, rolls, and waffles. So if you want to make a real saving on a quality food, buy this nourishing spread that tastes so good. P-A-R-K-A-Y. Parquet margarine, made by Kraft.
He said I'd be back, and he was right. Good night, everybody.
The Great Gildersleeve is played by Harold Peary. It is written by John Wheaton and Sam Moore. The music is by Jack Meekin. This is John Lang speaking for the Kraft Foods Company and inviting you to listen in again next week for the further adventures of The Great Gildersleeve. Ladies, here's how to be ready at the drop of a hat with sandwiches, snacks, and appetizers. Keep a package of delicious Pabstet cheese food in your refrigerator. Pabstet is ready in a jiffy, can be served 100 different ways. It spreads, melts, slices, toasts to perfection. Any way you serve it, any time you serve it, your family and guests are sure to like Pabstet's mellow cheddar cheese flavor. Pabstet comes in two popular varieties, golden cheddar and pimento. So head up your shopping list with delicious Pabstet cheese food. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
November 18th, 1945, The Great Gildersleeve on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Then we head to Kansas City, an episode of the Hallmark Playhouse starring Jack Benny, My Financial Career. That's up next, but first...
Mom, can I take this can of used back to the store and keep the money?
Why, yes. But what made you think about doing that all of a sudden?
Well, heck, Mom. They got a big sign in the store about it. They're paying real money for this used fat now.
Yes, you may be surprised at how much dealers are paying for used fats these days. It soon counts up. You see, used fats are still needed very much. This country and the whole world are still short of oils for making soap and other industrial products. So whether you let Junior keep the change or use the money to cut down your grocery bills, it pays to save every drop of used fat.
We continue now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox with an episode of the Hallmark Playhouse. This episode goes back 75 years to November 18, 1948. The episode entitled My Financial Career, and it stars who else? Jack Benny.
Remember, a Hallmark card when you care enough to send the very best. Tonight, from Hollywood, the makers of Hallmark greeting cards bring you Mr. Jack Benny in Stephen Leacock's My Financial Career on the Hallmark Playhouse. Each week, Hallmark will bring you Hollywood's greatest stars in outstanding stories chosen by one of the world's best-known authors, Mr. James Hilton. For a Christmas greeting your friends will long remember, make your selections now from the complete Hallmark collection on display at the friendly store where you buy Hallmark cards. Whatever your taste, whatever your budget, you'll take special pride in sending Hallmark cards. And on the back of every one is the identifying Hallmark that says, you cared enough to send the very best. And now it is Hallmark's pleasure to present the distinguished novelist, Mr. James Hilton.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is James Hilton. Tonight, the Hallmark Playhouse presents the dramatization of a short story by Stephen Leacock entitled My Financial Career. Since this story concerns a man and a bank and the insertion of the man's funds thereinto, we of the Hallmark Playhouse felt that the role of the man should be portrayed by an actor with a thorough knowledge of banking and a deep love and a great respect for all matters monetary. In casting about for such a personality, one name kept cropping up, and that name was Jack Benny. Accordingly, we opened negotiations with Mr. Benny, and after 3 days in a hotel room, we managed to conclude a financial arrangement which satisfied him and still left a few pennies for the Hallmark people. Our staff of attorneys and economic consultants unanimously agreed that it was the most difficult and complicated transaction since 1803. When Thomas Jefferson purchased the Louisiana Territory from France. In view of Mr. Benny's long and familiar association with banking institutions and his easy insouciance in dealing with them, it is paradoxical that in our play tonight, he portrays a character who suffers from an overwhelming dread of banks and bankers. This is perhaps the most challenging role in Mr. Benny's career and should provide the severest test of his histrionic ability. And now, without further preamble, we present Mr. Jack Benny as Rodney Beamish in our very free adaptation of Stephen Leacock's My Financial Career.
My name is Rodney Beamish. I'm married and have 3 children, a son 26, a daughter 12, and a little boy just 6 months old. I don't believe in rushing things. In dress, I'm conservative. I always wear a black frock coat, a derby hat, and I ride to work every day on a bicycle. For the past 19 years, I have been employed as a troubleshooter in the zipper department of the Eagle Clothes Company. My wife and I and our three children share a large, airy, comfortable room in a modern, attractive garage. I mention all these things to show that I'm a normal, average citizen. Yet, I was singled out by fate to bear an awful burden. All my life, I have been a slave to one terrible, morbid obsession. I, Rodney Beamish, am possessed with an overpowering, craven dread of banks. The very moment that I crossed the threshold of a bank, my knees turned to water and I sort of float the rest of the way in. However, for the past 19 years, I've been saving my money, a little each month. Until now, I had amassed too large a sum to keep in the house. $56. So fighting against an unreasoning fear, I started out for the bank, holding the money clutched in a crumpled ball in my pocket. When I neared the doors of the Security First National, my nerve gave out. I stopped in my tracks, unable to take another step. The doorman looked at me suspiciously. And after a couple of hours, he walked over to me.
Hey, mister, we don't allow loafing in front of the bank.
What?
You've been hanging around for 2 hours.
Well, I plan on going in.
You ain't the impulsive type, are you?
No, no, it's just that... Well, I guess I'm just plain frightened.
What's the matter, bud? You overdrawn?
No, no, it's a psychosis.
Psy-who?
Psychosis. It's Freudian. Do you know Freud?
Not by name, but if he's a depositor, I know his face.
No, you don't understand. It's a complex. I'm afraid of banks. I've always been afraid of them.
Well, maybe something happened a long time ago that scared you. Did you ever lose money in a bank?
I never lost money anywhere. But wait a minute. Something did happen to me a long time ago.
It was before I was married. I was going with a girl named Alexis Lujak. She was a chocolate dipper in a candy factory. When I took her out, I loved to hold hands with her all evening and then go home and lick my fingers. I remember now, I went to call on her one night. When I got to her house, there was another fellow waiting for her. His name was Bull Jensen, and he was sort of a local tough. Bull was handy with his fists, but that meant nothing to me. I just put on my glasses and sat down.
What are you doing here, stupid?
Oh, hello, Bull. I've got a date with Alexis.
Oh, you have, eh?
Bull, cut it out, will you? Let go of my wrist. You're hurting me. Let go.
Why don't you make me?
Ouch! Ouch!
Say, what do I have to do to you to make you fight back?
Oh, no, I'm not going to tell you my secrets.
Let go of Rodney this minute or I'll never talk to you again.
Talk. Who wants to talk?
Ouch!
Now get out of here.
Rodney, you come back here. Who are you going to listen to, Bull or me?
So the guy beat you up and you ran out. What's that got to do with being afraid of banks?
I didn't tell you, but Bull Jensen's father worked in a bank.
It still don't make sense. Now, come on, walk right in. I'll help you. You see? Why, there's nothing to it.
Before I knew what was happening, I was inside the bank. My temples throbbed, the muscles of my throat constricted. My whole body quivered in the grip of horrible fear. I staggered over to one of the windows. The teller looked at my haggard face as if to say, "What's the matter, sir? Is there anything wrong?" And then he said,
"What's the matter, sir? Is there anything wrong?"
I explained to the teller that banks rattled me. He was an intelligent chap and tried to help.
"If you'll pardon me for saying so, sir, I'd venture that your trouble can be traced to some psychological upheaval in the past."
Now, that's what I keep telling myself, but I just won't listen.
"Try to think back, sir. Is there any incident you remember that would have some bearing on this neurosis?"
No, nothing. But wait. Yes, I do remember an incident.
It happened. happened many years ago when I was in college. How the girls used to flock around me when I played my mandolin. Oh, I was handsome in those days. My chestnut hair was naturally wavy. And sometimes an unruly curl would slip down and nestle against my forehead. I had flashing white teeth. And when I smiled, two dimples would hold my mouth in parentheses. Our football team was playing State U in the biggest game of the year. And we were losing 76-0 with only 2 minutes left in the game. It was beginning to look bad for our side. But the coach had been saving me for just such an emergency.
Beamish! Beamish!
Yes, coach.
Go in at quarter.
There was a roar from the crowd as I put on my helmet, whipped off my blanket, and ran out on the field. I looked down and realized I had left my pants in the locker room. The coach rushed out another pair and we went into a huddle. It was a tense moment, but they fit. The crowd roared. It was do or die, and I was willing to do. I lowered my head and charged into the line, but it was like hitting a stone wall. I found out later they were wearing concrete jerseys. Everything went black, and when I woke up, I was in the hospital. My head was so swollen, it was 2 years after I graduated before I could take off my helmet.
Well, that was unfortunate, Mr. Beamish. But what has it got to do with your being afraid of banks?
Our team lost the game. I failed when they were banking on me.
But that's not reasonable. Now, why don't you pull yourself together and state your business?
I want to open an account.
There. You said it. Now, wasn't that easy? Just step over to that desk and ask for our cashier, Mr. Williams.
I turned and started to walk across the floor. And then once more, my strength seemed to melt. Again, I was in the grip of that nameless dread, that relentless creeping fear. I felt myself sinking into the bottom of the pit. A light in my brain exploded to 1,000 colors. Brown, orange, green, and that certain shade of blue that was so becoming to me. And then the bottom fell out of the world, and I crashed down into the black abyss of oblivion.
In a moment, James Hilton will return to present the second act of My Financial Career, starring Jack Benny. But first, wouldn't you like to send Christmas cards this year so unusual, so beautiful, that your friends will show them to all who visit them during the holiday season? Then visit the friendly store where you buy Hallmark cards. See his collection of Hallmark personal Christmas cards and see how true it is that whatever your taste, whatever your budget, there's a Hallmark card that you'll be proud to send. You'll be fascinated by albums of Christmas cards illustrated by famous gallery artists. Cards rich with the feel of silken tapestry. And the cards for men with hunting scenes that set any man to dreaming. But tonight, I'd like to tell you especially about the Hallmark Blue Book. For on every page of this beautiful album is a Hallmark card that's a heartwarming reflection of the Christmas spirit. You'll see a jolly Santa Claus, a toy train full of good wishes, reindeer poised for flight, evergreen so fresh you can almost smell their fragrance. The sparkling snow of a white Christmas. Yes, they're all here. All these and many more of the well-beloved Christmas symbols in Hallmark personal cards that you'll be proud to send. Cards your friends will be proud to receive. For when they see the Hallmark on the back, they'll know you cared enough to send the very best. Here again is James Hilton.
As we begin the second act of my financial career with Jack Benny as Rodney Beamish, we return you to the hard stone floor of the Security First National Bank upon which Rodney has just collapsed. The mysterious hysteria that seizes him whenever he enters a bank still holds him in merciful unconsciousness. But now he's beginning to stir.
I felt myself floating in a gentle sea and soft waves were splashing over my face. And then I realized that it wasn't a sea. I was lying on the floor in the bank. I had fainted and they were trying to revive me by throwing water in my face.
I'm terribly sorry, Mr. Beamish, but we didn't have any water handy, so we had to use ink.
I looked down and saw that my white shirt was now a blue polka dot. I offered to pay for the ink, but they wouldn't hear of it. They even gave me some blotter so I could dry myself. The teller was very kind. He tried to soothe me. We chatted for about 15 minutes, and then he helped me up off the floor. I thanked him.
Now, Mr. Beamish, why don't you see our cashier, Mr. Williams, and tell him exactly what you want?
I walked over to Mr. Williams, still shaky from my experience. He greeted me cordially.
Well, well, are we feeling better now?
We? I didn't know he had been sick, too. I apologized to Mr. Williams and explained my phobia. He was very understanding.
My dear Mr. Beamish, this obsession of yours about banks is merely a quirk, a twist of mind, probably incurred through some incident in the past. Perhaps as a youth you had some trouble concerning a bank.
No, no, not in my youth. But wait a minute. Yes, I do remember an incident in the past.
When I was 37 years old, I ran away from home. I was determined to see the world. I made my way to San Francisco and found myself in a waterfront dive. There was a tinny piano playing, and the place was full of sailors. They fascinated me with their lusty manners and their salty talk.
Ahoy, matey! Mind if an old sailor drops anchor alongside?
I looked up and saw a typical old seaman standing at the bar next to me. He had an ugly scar that ran from ear to ear, and a sort of nasal twang where his nose should have been. I didn't want him to think I was a landlubber, so I tried to act nautical. I said, "Shiver me timbers," and asked him if he'd ever been around the Horn.
"Captain Hook's my name. I've sailed the seven seas for 40 years, man and boy, and neither of us ever regretted it."
I stood there and listened to him spin his briny yarns. He was the skipper of the Nancy B, a trim little steamer out of Seattle by War Admiral. When the time came to pay the check, we both reached for our money. And it was then I envied him. He didn't have any. Suddenly, a feeling of weakness came over me. My legs started to buckle. I tried to unbuckle them, but it was no use. Too late, I sensed that I had been drugged. And I knew I was being shanghaied. I regained consciousness in the boiler room of the Nancy B. Two stockers were stripped to the waist. Or is it stokers? Yes, it's stokers. Anyway, one of them kicked me in the head.
Hi, matey. Briggs is my name.
I'm pleased to meet you, Mr. Briggs.
He stuck a shovel in my hand and pointed to the blazing furnace.
Need it.
I flung a shovel full of coal into the fiery pit, and a tongue of flame shot out and licked my hand gratefully. Then the hatch opened and Captain Hook came in. No longer was he the kindly old tar I had met in the waterfront saloon. Now he was a cruel, bloody tyrant.
Avast, you scurvy, skulking swine! Lift that shovel! Tote that bale! Get a little drunk and you'll land in the brig.
He had the lyrics all wrong. But I wasn't going to tell him.
When you work for Captain Hook, you work 26 hours a day.
26 hours a day? I thought it was impossible. But he came down later and made me set my watch back 2 hours. It was miserable down in the stokehole. I longed for a breath of fresh air, and one night, I reached the deck unobserved, and I saw a girl coming toward me. She was the most beautiful creature I'd ever seen. And grimy as I was, she was glad to meet me. She said I reminded her of an old boyfriend, a coal miner from Scranton. Her name was Stella. She was a passenger on the ship, and she told me all about herself.
I hated to make this trip. I've been away for so long. First, I had to go to Paris, and then Egypt, Rio, and Australia. And then when I get back, I'll have to go to Honolulu.
But why do you keep doing it if you don't like it?
I can't help it. You see, 2 years ago, I hit the giant jackpot on a quiz show. And I've been traveling ever since.
I felt a strong bond between this girl and myself. Fate had played a cruel trick on both of us. But for this one fleeting moment, we were free and the moon was beautiful. She leaned toward me and I reached out to enfold her when suddenly Captain Hook was there ahead of me. He kissed her. And then with a twinkle in his eye, he turned to me and said,
"You skulking swine! Get back to your hole before I slit your gullet!"
As he dragged me away by the gullet... Stella stared at me uncomprehendingly. There was a wistful look in her eyes, a knowledge of things that were not to be. I never saw Stella again.
Mr. Beamish, I realize you went through a terrible ordeal, but why should that make you afraid of banks?
Oh, I neglected to tell you. Captain Hook had me flogged because I had forgotten to bank the fire.
But that's not good logic. Now, why don't you just forget all that and tell me how much you would like to deposit?
Well, first, I want to see the president alone.
Alone?
I don't know why I said alone, but Mr. Williams nodded and fetched the president. My fingers tightened on my $56. "Are you the president?" I asked him.
"Yes, I'm the president."
"I'm pleased to meet you, Mr. Truman."
"The name is Dewey."
"Dewey?"
"Cornelius J. Dewey. I'm president of this bank."
"Oh.
Step this way, please. We'll be safe from interruption here. You are one of Pinkerton's men, I presume?"
He had gathered from my appearance that I was a detective. I explained that my feet were naturally flat. I had been born with fallen arches. He looked surprised and asked me what I wanted of him.
"What do you want of me?"
"I want of you to open an account." "I intend of you to keep all my money in this bank. Of you."
"Please sit down, Mr. Beamish. Will you have a cigarette?"
"Thanks. Lucky strikes."
"Ah, yes." "They're first again with bankers, too." Mr. Beamish, you say you're going to keep all your money in this bank?
"Yes, all of it."
"Well, that's wonderful. Exactly how much cash do you propose to deposit, Mr. Beamish?"
$56.
$56? Mr. Williams!
"Yes, sir?"
"This gentleman is opening an account. He will deposit $56. Good day, Beamish."
I felt myself getting rattled again. I went back to Mr. Williams and handed him the $56. He took the money, made me write the sum on a slip and sign my name in a book. I no longer knew what I was doing.
"There you are, Mr. Beamish."
"Is it deposited?"
"It is."
I told him I wanted to draw a check. My idea was to take out $6. I had to have some money to carry me through the month. He handed me a checkbook. I wrote something on it and thrust it back at him. He looked at me in amazement.
What? Are you drawing it all out again?
Miserably, I realized that I had written 56 instead of 6. Reckless with panic, I tried to brazen it through. I nodded.
You're withdrawing all your money from the bank?
Every cent.
How will you have it?
What?
I said, how will you have the $56?
In 50s.
50s? All right, here's a $50 bill. Now, how do you want the 6?
In 6s.
He gave it to me. I thrust it into my pocket and started for the door. I only thought to escape from this devilish mausoleum. Odd fragments of my life flashed in front of my eyes in a crazy, unrelated pattern. The center snapped the ball back to me. Then I realized it wasn't a ball. It was Stella. I tucked her under my arm and started off tackle. As I broke through the line, I came face to face with my old girlfriend, Alexis Lujak. She was dipping Captain Hook into a vat of chocolate. Poor Denson's face loomed up in front of me. My head whirled. I knew I had to get to my bicycle. I made my way to the street in freedom. I pedaled away from that bank as fast as I could. And I was halfway home before I realized I didn't have my bicycle. But I was making such good time, I couldn't stop pedaling. Besides, I'd never again go back to any bank. Let him keep my bicycle. I didn't care, because I was free. Free! 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 Free!
Mr. Benny, on behalf of the Hallmark Playhouse, I want to thank you for a wonderful half hour.
Well, thank you, Mr. Hilton. I enjoyed it myself, even though Hallmark is a competitor of mine. You know, I carry a line of Christmas cards, too.
You know, actually, Mr. Benny, Hallmark has no competitors. You see, we use the most famous artists, the best engraving, and only the finest grades of paper for our cards.
Oh. Well, mine aren't quite that elaborate. I use the cardboard that comes back from the laundry in my shirt. And this time of year, there are a lot of Christmas advertising in the magazines, some beautiful pictures, and I clip them out and paste them on cardboards. They make lovely cards. I happen to have one right here with me if you'd care to look at it. Here is one. Here it is.
Thank you. Hmm. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year from two lovely ladies. Which twin has the Tony?
Isn't that a beautiful sentiment?
Well, it's very expressive.
I just have a couple of dozen left at 50 cents apiece.
Hallmark puts out a very fine card for as little as 5 cents.
5 cents? Well, no wonder things have been so slow with me. Say, do you suppose I could carry the Hallmark line at the wholesale distributor's price, I mean?
Well, Hallmark cards are sold only in carefully selected retail stores. Do you have a retail store?
No. No, but I have a beautiful suitcase and a connection with the police department. I've got one of the best corners in Beverly Hills, you know.
Well, drop in and we'll discuss it. Good night, Jack.
Good night, Mr. Chips. I mean, Mr. Hilton. Gee, with Hallmark cards, I can double my business. Wait till I tell Mary about this.
Goodbye, Jack Benny. And thanks again for the delightful nonsense. Next week on the Hallmark Playhouse, we will present Rose Wilder Lane's Free Land, starring Martha Scott. And on succeeding weeks, we will bring you Victor Moore, Ida Lupino, and the finest stars in Hollywood. So make Thursday night your Hallmark Playhouse night. Until next Thursday, then, this is James Hilton saying good night.
That home of your own, education for your children, leisure time, all these can be part of your future if you invest in United States savings bonds now. The sure way to save is the automatic way, through the payroll savings plan where you work or the bond a month plan where you bank.
Protect your future with United States Savings Bonds. Tonight's story was adapted for radio by Hugh Wedlock and Howard Snyder, with music composed and conducted by Lynn Murray. Our director-producer is Dee Engelbach. Look for Hallmark cards that are sold only in stores that have been carefully selected to give you expert and friendly service. Remember Hallmark cards when you care enough to send the very best. This is Frank Goss saying goodnight to you all until next week at the same time, when James Hilton returns to present Rose Wilder Lane's Free Land, starring Martha Scott. This program came to you from the Hallmark Playhouse. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Oh, my God, an utter screwball comedy with Jack Benny from the Hallmark Playhouse 75 years ago, November 18th, 1948. Speaking of screwballs, Milton Berle is up next on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. But first...
America in step for victory. America marshaling its energies for war. American soldiers at the front. A great civilian army lending them support behind the lines. Yes, the American people are determined that nothing shall stand in the way of total victory. Patriotically, they are rationing their goods and resources to make huge bomber fleets, great tank corps, mighty battle squadrons available to our young men in the Army and Navy. Americans know that the sacrifices they are making on the home front are small compared to the sacrifices of the men on the battlefront.
World War II was won by everyone. Now, let's go to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Oh, wait, that's me. That's what we're doing here, isn't it? 76 years ago, November 18th, 1947. We could never air all of the Lucky Strikes, Philip Morris stuff here in the show when we used to be on broadcast radio. And now we can let you hear all, as Sean puts it, Dunnigan put it, saying how healthy cigarettes used to be. Let's hear from Johnny and Philip Morris.
Make no mistake, of all leading cigarettes, one and only one is recognized by eminent nose and throat specialists as definitely less irritating. That one cigarette is Philip Morris. Johnny presents the Milton Berle Show. Here comes Johnny, ladies and gentlemen, to remind you, if every smoker knew what Philip Morris smokers know, they'd all change to Philip Morris. Yes, they'd all...
Puff up, Philip Murray!
From Radio City in New York, here is the Milton Berle Show. With Bert Telton, Jack Albertson, Mary Shipp, Billy Sands, Johnny Gibson, Al Kelly, our singing star Dick Farney, the music of Ray Block and his orchestra, and yours truly, Frank Gallup. Ladies and gentlemen...
Oh, you're dynamite tonight.
Last week, the Metropolitan Opera Company opened its gala season. We now bring you a man who, at every opening night of the opera, has always had his own box.
That's right.
He sells neckties off of it. And here he is, Milton Berle.
Thank you. Thank you, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Gallup, I challenge that wild and ridiculous statement that you just made. I really do. Let me set the record right and straight. I have never sold one tie in front of the Manhattan... what town is this? I have never sold one tie in front of the Metropolitan Opera House. Not one tie. That's why I switched to selling razor blades. Razor blades. Strop me if you heard that one. Strop me? We're going to have fun up here. Why don't you join us? Razor blades. No brush, no lather, no rub in, no joke, no laugh, no program. Good night, show's over. Everybody dance. Oh, Mr. Gallup, that's how I like to start a program. Right off with a flying lull. Mr. Mr. Gallup, I missed it. Were you at the opera opening night?
Was I, Frank Gallup, at the opening of the opera?
I just asked.
Burl, was Washington at Valley Forge?
Yes.
Was Napoleon at Waterloo?
But Mr. Gallup,
was Lincoln at Gettysburg?
Were you at the opera opening night?
No.
Mr. Gallup, I don't know what I'd do without you, but I'd like to give it a try. Ah, the opera, Mr. Gallup. Madame Butterfly, the Merry Wives of Windsor. Mr. Gallup, do you know the Merry Wives of Windsor?
No, but I know a widow in Cucamonga. Oh, I do declare that was a jolly rejoinder.
Yes. That was jazzy, wasn't it? That was a peacherino. Mr. Gallup, what memories of my career in the opera?
Burl, you were in opera.
Well, of course. Ask Lawrence Tibbett. He couldn't get along without me. Remember Pagliacci, where he sang, Ridi Pagliacci.
You were with him?
With him? Who do you think tickled him? Mr. Gallup, in my prime, I sang every opera. Rigoletto, La Donna Mobile, La Donna Mobile.
I say, can you sing Faust?
I didn't hear what you said.
Can you sing Faust?
I'll try. La Donna Mobile, La Donna Mobile, La Donna Mobile, La Donna.
Burl, that's Faust?
That's as Faust as I can sing. As Faust as I can sing it, old Burl. How can one man be so funny and still have to plant his mother in the audience to start the laughs? I'm sorry, Mr. Gallup. I've hogged the entire show with my dynamic material. So let's hear from you now. Do you have something to say?
No, but I know a widow in Cucamonga.
Mr. Gallup, you just told that gag. Some of the yolk is still wet on your chin. The first time you told that joke, it was nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Burl, someday that joke will be bigger than What a Blow for Princess Elizabeth.
Mr. Gallup, someday... You're going too far, you know that. And when you do, I hope you can find your way back. I hope you can't find your way back. See? That's what you get for letting ushers write your material. But nevertheless, tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we salute the opera. Grand opera. What can be more thrilling than sitting in the Met cheering Traviata, Rigoletto, Otello? Nothing, unless it's sitting in the bleachers cheering DiMaggio, Rizzuto, and Lavaggetto. But let us learn a little more about the opera. First, we have Grand Opera. Notice that Grand Opera is grand, pompous, slow. And the audience reaction to Grand Opera is this. The other type of opera is light opera. I want you to notice that light opera is light, fast, and gay. The audience reaction to light opera is this. In other words, the difference between grand opera and light opera is simply this. Thank you, Toot Snore. Ladies and gentlemen, it is our belief that once you understand what is being sung, you too will love opera. And it is our pleasure tonight to have as our guest the celebrated operatic contralto, Madame Rosa Manicotti. And to interpret for you what Madame Manicotti will sing is none other than that well-known translator of opera librettos, Mr. Andre Finster. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Finster.
Thank you.
Mr. Finster, I understand that you will translate as... Wait till he does it, lady, please. My mother's timing is off tonight. I understand, Mr. Finster, that you will translate as Madame Manicotti sings excerpts from the famous opera Un Ballo in Moscar.
Yes. It is better known in this country as the legend of the gypsy Croy that we have marshaled in for Croy because there's no chance of a trade for our film very short. It's in three acts.
In three acts, all right. Would you, Mr. Finster, set the scene?
Gladly.
All right.
As the curtain rises, we find ourselves in the kingdom of Stamagrobli Place of the kind of prayer. The merry villagers run out on the stage in a holiday mood. And why not? It is Schmalman Day. They are dressed in long, flowing gotkas. And on their heads they carry baskets full of steaming shrimp, blicks, and moiment flay, which is very style. This is the national dish.
Oh, yes, the national dish, sure. Well, go on, Mr. Finster.
Well, at this point, Carmelita comes on the stage. She's really the Princess Schmarulia Play, which is caught.
Yes.
But she's disguised as a kniv of a Marcia Play because that's a famine.
Yeah.
Now, this is because her sweetheart Antonio wants to cloyd her funny with a clap of it. He wants to cloyd her funny with a clap of it. Who doesn't? And when she sees her lover, she sings.
She sings? Go ahead, Madam Manicotti.
Una bella en mascara, ma bolino la marfido bio.
Lovely, Madam Manicotti. Quick, Mr. Finster, what did she just sing?
She sang to her lover, my sweet, my heart, my carbonical clad dead. At this point, her sweetheart leaps over a trove and plays the bass, which is very dumb, like I said. She thinks she's got a mustache.
I see. May we have the second act, Madam Manicotti, please?
La mazzupanino nella Luigina progressivo bio.
Beautiful. Well, Mr. Finster?
Her father, King Maya Croy, did not say. He wants her to marry the old duke, and she answered, marry that old driving and faith? Two! What do I look like, a Vimers? What do you make me for, a Schmeidelbe? I would rather Davin say, put that in your halberd and grim it.
Yes, and go on.
Her father roars, are you going to marry the duke? And she answers,
Mr. Finster, what did she say?
She said yes.
And, Mr. Finster, tell us, how does the opera end?
Just as Carmelita's about to marry the Duke,
yes,
Antonio the beggar throws off his rags and says, look, I am not Antonio the beggar. I am Fidel the feeder home. And as they ride into the sunset, the old king shakes his fist and says, what a blow for Prince and Mahayaya, quite now.
Thank you, Ozzy and Harriet. Thank you.
Memphis, Tennessee, Buffalo, New York, Denver, Colorado, Portland, Oregon. Yes, from all over the country there's news, big news. Listen.
From section after section, eminent nose and throat specialists report that in cases of irritation due to smoking, they suggest change to Philip Morris.
Yes, these top-ranking nose and throat specialists actually suggest Philip Morris because they know Philip Morris is the one, the only leading cigarette proved definitely less irritating.
Remember, the cigarette that gives you the least irritation is the cigarette that gives you the most enjoyment. After all, it's pleasure, deep, rich pleasure that counts in smoking. And the full measure of smoking pleasure is yours to enjoy day in, day out in Philip Morris. That's why we say, if every smoker knew what Philip Morris smokers know, they'd all change to Philip Morris, America's finest cigarette.
Very quick. Flash Gordon made that arrangement. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Brahms' Hungarian Dance, played by Ray Block. That was only the first course. Played by Ray Block and the Philip Morris Orchestra. And Ray, you are really wonderful. I can honestly call you the Gustav Henschen of tomorrow. I might also say you are the Harry Hawlick of yesterday. Believe me, anything is better than the Ray Block of today. That was Berle 4 years ago. Low state. Thank you. And now, as we continue our salute to the great music, we present
Music Forum tonight. Music Forum tonight. The question: should we find another Carmen Lombardo, or should we throw away the one we have?
He knows a widow in Cucamonga. Let's see. Let's get right to the questions from the audience with our forum. Let's start with this gentleman in the aisle toasting marshmallows. Yes, sir?
Mr. Berle, have you ever made any phonograph records?
Why, yes, I've made many records.
You have?
Yes.
Now I know I did the right thing. I'm glad I did it.
Who are you?
Petrillo.
Thank you. That's a local joke. Local 802. But let us go on. All right, this young man here with his head caught in the cuspidor. Young man, what is your name?
My name is Lucy Monroe.
Lucy Monroe?
Don't confuse me with the one that sings at ball games.
Oh, no, I won't.
I only took the name because I love America.
I see. What's your real name?
Patrick Henry.
All right, Pat, you have a question concerning music?
Yeah, but you don't think I'm going to ask you for advice, do you?
Well, we're trying...
What, are you an authority on music all of a sudden?
No, but we...
I heard you sing already, and take it from me, you're a big nothing.
Now, look,
you've got a voice that's flatter than the top of your head.
If you'll just...
I've heard better sounds coming out of a pair of new shoes.
But you don't...
I've heard nicer music coming out of a vacuum cleaner, a broken boiler, a dying chicken.
Please, I'm...
Ah, your father's pitch pipe.
Please. We must control ourselves. Let us get on to the women now. All right, this young lady in third row sewing up the stuffed turkey neck. Young... What is your name, please?
Tallulah Feeney. I'm a homemaker.
I see. And you have a question that has to do with music?
Yeah. How can I stop my husband from taking up all them corny instruments? He's ickier than a box of wet does.
Your husband studies musical instruments?
He tried to take up the violin, but for that fathead, it was too confusing.
The violin was too confusing?
He didn't know which chin to rest it on.
I see.
He didn't have any luck with the cello, either.
He couldn't play the cello?
Nah, he's so bow-legged, it kept slipping through his legs.
He should have used a big bass fiddle.
That was too big. It'd give him saddle sores.
I understand.
He finally took up the bugle. The way he blows that bugle's amazing.
What's amazing about blowing a bugle?
With his nose.
Oh, that's different.
He took up the trumpet, but he had a terrible accident.
What happened?
He inhaled and the trumpet got stuck in his throat.
The trumpet stuck in his throat?
Yeah, every time he hiccuped, he sounded like Harry James.
But you did get the trumpet out.
Yeah, but he can't play it no more. He swallowed the valve.
He swallowed the valve?
Yeah, now when he feels like playing the trumpet, he starts fingering his stomach.
Thank you, Mrs. Feeney. Thank you very much. Thank you. And now, ladies and gentlemen, as the climax of our musical forum tonight, we are very honored to have none other than that great American opera star whose powerful, thundering bass voice is world famous, the one and only Tito Featherfield. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Featherfield.
Thank you, Mr. Berle. May I take this golden opportunity to thank my many admirers for sending me those hundreds of bouquets of flowers from all over the United States, so wherever I sing, I smell.
Well, tell us, Tito.
Excuse me, Mr. Berle.
Yes?
Do you mind if I sit down? What? I'm pooped.
You're pooped? You're tired?
On the way here, I picked a string off the sidewalk. I think I strained myself.
Oh, but Mr. Featherfield, a string isn't heavy.
Well, this one had knots in it.
Oh, well, that's different. Tito, it's amazing. You look so fragile, and yet you have such a magnificent voice.
Isn't it the truth, though?
Yeah.
They used to call me the second Lawrence Melchior.
I see. What made them stop?
Lawrence Melchior.
Mr. Featherfield, I understand that when you sing, your faithful wife is always at your side.
Yes, it's gruesome, isn't it? But my wife and I do a wonderful scene together in The Barber of Seville. I'm the barber, and I sing as I'm shaving.
I see. What does your wife do?
Who do you think I'm shaving?
I see.
Last week, we were both in the opera Carmen.
Mm-hmm.
It was a big bullfight scene. I was the bullfighter.
I see. And your wife?
Mm-hmm. The bull.
Wait a minute. You were the bullfighter and your wife was the bull? What a bullfight that must have been.
Yes, Mr. Berle. It was the first time in the history of Carmen that the bull won.
Well, tell us, has your wife got a strong voice, too?
strong.
Has it?
Mr. Burl, remember how the great Caruso, with one blast of his powerful lungs, could shatter a glass?
Yes, I do. I remember that.
My wife can shatter a new Studebaker. Driver and all.
Well, let's get back to music, Mr. Featherfield. Is it true that music can stir up human passions?
Absolutely, Mr. Burl.
It is, huh?
There's one song, the minute I hear it, I want to grab a gun and start shooting.
What song is that?
The Wedding March.
Thank you, Mr. Featherfield. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, here's our young singing star, Dick Fawney, to sing.
Who knows how much I love you? You do. No one means more to me than you do. You take December. Smile it ain't too many, and then December comes back again when you're away. Who has a chance? That's very few do. Who makes life necessary? You do. And who can take my dreams and make my dreams come true? Don't give me three guesses, one will do. And take my dreams and make my dreams come true. Don't give me three guesses, one will do.
You know, when Dick Fawney sings, it sounds like it's coming from the stage of Tristan and Isolde. Because when I sing, it sounds like it's from the basement of Hammacher and Schlemmer. For the out-of-town listeners, that's a hardware store in New York. This program may not be funny, but by gum, at least you're knowing to know what's going... Why did you walk in when I didn't finish? You walked in at the wrong time. Did you notice how he detracted walking up to this microphone? For a minute, I didn't know which was the mic. Well, what is it you want?
I'm waiting.
You're waiting? I wish you'd have waited 2 seconds longer. You might have gotten a laugh.
I am waiting for you to explain to the musical world why I, Frank Gallup, was not at the opening of the opera this year, thanks to you.
Very dramatic tonight, huh? All right, I was going to tail this, but I will. We have about 5 minutes left, and who wants to listen to Ray Block? I do. I do. And you do. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll tell you the reason why you weren't at the... I wasn't with you. Who was going? Oh, both of you. You know... It'd be funny if this is an audition and I don't know it. Last week, Mr. Gallup, for the first time, ladies and gentlemen, he invited me and my wife to the opening of the Metropolitan Opera. And that night, we were having Mr. Gallup and his wife over for dinner at our house. And as we were waiting for the Gallups, I'll never forget. Gee, imagine going to the opera with the Gallops. Quick, dear, look, does my tuxedo look good on me?
Yes, Milton, just remember to keep your hand out of your coat pocket.
Oh, I will.
One squeeze of that bulb in there and your shirt lights up. Call for Philip Morris.
I know. I disconnected the batteries. Now, remember, dear, the Gallops are very ritzy, very Park Avenue. Now, this is the first time they've ever been in Jackson Heights. They'll probably bring camping equipment. Oh, that's the Gallops. Now, quick, is my tie on straight?
Yes, but your head isn't.
Oh, that's good. That's funny. Coming. Well, well, Mr. and Mrs. Gallop, come right in.
Thank you, Burl. Where shall I,
Oh, yeah, here, I'll take the sleeping bags. There.
My dear, this is Milton Berle, the man I've been telling you about.
How do you do, Mrs. Gallup?
Amazing.
Amazing?
Only one head.
Mrs. Gallup, this is my wife, Mrs. Milton Berle.
How do you do, Mrs. Gallup?
Oh, you poor thing.
Well, 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 here we are, aren't we?
Yes. And we're all in it together.
Well, 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 dinner will be ready soon. Mrs. Gallup, can I get you a drink?
Please, don't bother going out to the still just for me.
Well, well, well. Say, Mr. Gallup, I want to tell you some of the jokes that I have for next week's program.
Please, Burl, not in front of the ladies.
Oh, I see. If you women will excuse us.
Of course.
Come, my dear, let us adjourn to the dining room and stare at each other.
Well, well, well. Mr. Gallup, your wife is a very, very lovely woman.
Oh, well, thank you. Of course, once you get to know her, she's really quite a bore.
Well, as long as you love her.
Burl, don't get vulgar.
I'm sorry, Mr. Gallup. Now, for next Tuesday's show,
Excuse me, Burl, but hadn't you better dress for the opera? We won't have time later.
Dress? I am dressed. I'm wearing this tuxedo.
That tuxedo?
Yes.
Burl, that looks like something Barney unloaded on Simon Ackerman.
No, but Mr. Gallup, I don't own a full-dress suit like yours.
Sorry, Burl. In that suit, you'll disgrace me. It's all off. I'll just call my wife and we'll leave. Una?
Una? Mr. Gallup, going to the opera in your company means a lot to me.
Obviously.
Sure.
Una?
Well, I just remembered there's a place on 10th Avenue, the Owl Clothing Company. They're open all night.
The Owl Clothing?
Yeah, I'll rush right over there. You go ahead and eat without me. I'll get a full dress suit and meet you in front of the Opera House. Oh, boy. What a neighborhood. Oh, here's the place. Owl Clothers. We never sleep. I'll go in. Boy, it's dark in here.
Pardon me, friend. Did you come in here for some high-grade clashy-wearing apparel?
No, I just came in here to get a picture of Vincent Lopez tattooed on my chest. Now, look, I'm in a hurry. I want a full dress suit.
You gonna make a purchase or just looking around?
Oh, no, I'm buying.
Good, then I'll turn on the light. Hello, Mr. Gogol.
Yes?
Is the door locked?
It's locked.
Okay, help the man off with his clothes.
Now, wait a minute. Hey, let go.
We're putting the new suit right on. You're in a hurry, you said?
Yeah, but be careful with that tuxedo. You'll short-circuit the shirt. Boy, it's cold standing here in just my shorts. Now, I would like a full dress suit.
Shut up!
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Now, I got a suit here that's meant just for you.
A full dress?
A genuine Hungarian goat herder's outfit.
Hungarian goat? Look, I want a full...
Shut up!
Yeah.
Just feel that material. Beaver lapels like these, they don't make anymore.
No, you don't understand. Look, I'm going to an opera, not Queen for a day. Show me something else.
I can't. We ain't got anything else.
You have nothing but Hungarian goat herders' outfits?
It's a job lot. I got them off a road company of Blossom Time that got lost in Jersey.
Now, look, I've had enough from you. I'm getting out of here right now.
Going somewhere, friend?
Yes, I'm gone. Where's Mr. Google in my old suit?
Google?
Yes.
Who's Google?
Who's good? You're kidding. You're kidding, aren't you?
Uh-uh.
Now, please. Just my pants. Mr. Gallup is waiting.
Shut up!
Yeah.
Tell you what I'll do. Buy this Hungarian goat herder's outfit and free of charge, I'll have the hem lowered.
Now, please, give me the suit.
This week, with every goat herder's outfit, we're giving a bottle of Airwick.
Give me the suit.
In this outfit, you'll be the talk of the stockyards.
Give me the suit.
Get a load of the lining. Genuine simulated cardboard.
Give me the suit.
And for only $100.
Give me the suit.
All right, $50. But that's almost final.
Give me...
Look. It's 9:00. Now, listen, you. Get my tuxedo or I'll report you to the police. The Better Business Bureau. I'll even go hire and take a direct to Charlie Luckman.
Okay. Go into the dressing room. I'll bring your suit.
Well, that's better. Where's the dressing room?
That door right there.
Okay, in a hurry. This door?
Yes.
Wait a minute. I'm out on the street. Open the door. Open up. I'll freeze to death. I'll go around the front. Oops. Pardon me, lady. Let me back in.
The overture is starting. Keep moving.
Oh, this is outrageous. We cannot wait any longer.
But I'm sure... Oh, here he comes.
I'm sorry, Mr. Gallup. I'll explain later. Let's go in.
Milton, what have you got on?
Burl, what is that atrocity?
It's a Hungarian goat herder's outfit. Feel those beaver lapels.
Why didn't you go to the Owl Clothiers like you said you would?
I was there, but this is all they had.
Oh, ridiculous. I was there looking for you 15 minutes ago. And what bargains? They sold me this suit. Look.
A tuxedo.
Oh, and that's not all. Look. The shirt lights up and says, "Call for Philip Morris."
Give me the show. Give me the show.
Remember this. You're twice as sure of twice the pleasure when you smoke Philip Morris. And here's why.
First, you enjoy the pleasure of smoking the world's finest premium tobaccos, mellow and mild and superbly blended. And second, you enjoy the extra pleasure of smoking the one, the only leading cigarette recognized by eminent nose and throat specialists as definitely less irritating.
Yes, you're twice as sure of twice the pleasure when you smoke Philip Morris. So next time you call for cigarettes, call for Philip Morris, made in America by Americans to please American tastes.
Thank you very much. We're a little late, folks. Good night, everyone. Good night.
Look for me. I'll be waiting for you. Come in and call for Philip Morris.
Yes, if every smoker knew what Philip Morris smokers know, they'd all change to Philip Morris, America's finest cigarette.
Call for Philip Morris.
Hello. Hello, testing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That's it, 5. Pipe smokers, try Revelation Pipe Tobacco, a smooth blend of 5 tobaccos. Yes, relax, take 5, take Revelation, a fine pipe tobacco. Take care of tomorrow today, the easy automatic way. Invest part of your weekly salary in the United States Savings Bond. The safest, most...
This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
Given that so much of his work when he was announcing was for the Metropolitan Opera, many people didn't know how funny Milton Cross really could be. The Milton Berle Show, with Milton Cross the announcer, 76 years ago, November 18th, 1947. All right, let's head to Pine Ridge, Arkansas, and see what's going on with the Lion and Lumen Abner here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. But first...
For 19 straight months, the cost of living kept going up and up and up. Then on May 18th, 1942, price control went into effect on most of the things you eat, most of the things you use, and most of the things you wear. Since that time, your cost of living has stopped climbing. Price control keeps down the cost of things you buy. It protects your dollar. It holds down the cost of rent in many areas. It assures you that the cost of most consumer services, services such as laundry and cleaning and household repairs, will not go up just at this time when you're making the things you now have last for the duration.
Tomorrow on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, a 1939 episode of Jack Benny, an episode of Phil Harris from 1950, a 1943 episode of Amos and Andy, an episode of the Old Gold Comedy Theater from 1944, and an episode of the soap opera Claudia. But right now, let's check in with Lyman Abner and the Lion. This episode of the program goes back to November 18th, 1941.
The makers of Alka-Seltzer bring you Lum and Abner. I know that none of you Lum and Abner listeners go around looking for trouble. At the same time, you know it's wise to be prepared for it, just in case. Now, take headaches, for example. You never know when this common ailment will cause you distress. You may be going out for the evening, may come right in the middle of one of your busiest days at work, or when you're all tired out and you want to get a good night's sleep. Well, now, because headaches do often catch you unawares, you'll be wise if you're prepared for relief in the pain and discomfort they cause. And, of course, that means that you should never be without a package of Alka-Seltzer tablets handy, both at home and at your place of work. You'll smile with relief when you take Alka-Seltzer for a headache because thanks to the remarkably effective analgesic pain reliever which it contains, you feel better fast. So, be wise. Take Alka-Seltzer and get the real relief it offers, not only for headaches, but for acid indigestion, muscular aches, pains and fatigue, and in cold distress as well. Remember, you can get Alka-Seltzer at all drugstores, by the package, and the glass. And now, let's see what's going on down in Pine Ridge. Well, Abner's plans to surprise Lum with a lion for the library didn't turn out so well. Abner, unaware that the lion had broken out of his cage, gaily shoved Lum into the back room of the store where the lion was running loose. As we look in on the little community today, we find Abner in the Jot'em Down store trying to patch up things with his very unhappy and jittery partner, Lum. Listen.
I don't know how you can get rid of it, but get rid of it somehow. A lion is the one thing in the world I don't want. Sell it or give it away or drown it or something.
Well, you said you wanted one, Lum. Fact says you told me you wanted two of them.
I said I wanted two lions?
Yes, sir, you sure did. Said if we're going to run a library, why, we ought to have two lions sitting right out there in front.
Oh.
You even showed me a picture of the New York library with the two lions they got there.
Yeah, but them weren't live lions. They're iron lions. Statues.
Statues?
Why, sure. Body with an ounce of sense would know that.
Well, you never said nothing about statues to me, Lum. All you said
was... I know what I said, and I ought to know better than to ever brung up the subject in the first place. Granny's, you can get things worse mixed up than every one feller I ever knowed in my life.
Well, I'm sorry. I was just trying my best to be nice to you.
I know you was, Abner, and I appreciate it, too. I know you was trying to do right, but after this, don't ever do nothing nice for me again till you check with me on it first.
All right, all right.
And get rid of that lion.
I will. I sure will. My dog, is it seems a shame, though, after I planned all week how you was going to be surprised when you seen it, Lum.
Don't worry. I was surprised, all right. That's the worst surprise I ever got in my whole life. Fact is, I ain't got over the shock of it yet.
You ain't, huh?
I know. I'm as nervous and jumpy as a rabbit's nose. Just look at my hands.
For the land's sake.
Still shaking there. I might not ever recover from this. I don't know.
Recover? Well, Lum, now, you didn't actually get hurt. Fact is, he never even scratched you.
No, but the shock of going through an experience like that can leave a man a shattered wreck. A broke shell.
It can.
Well, you don't know what it means to be shoved blindfolded in a room with a ferocious lion running loose.
Yeah, well, I never knowed he's loose, old Lum. Cedric never told me that in time to stop you.
Just the same, that's what happened. Grannies, I never was so scared in all my life. Walked in that feed room and opened my eyes, and as soon as they got used to the dark, what did I see? Two great big yeller eyes, six times as big as mine, charging straight at me. And that must be when he struck his first blow, because that's the last I recollect.
Why, Lum, he never struck you. You just fainted and fell on the floor there.
Fainted?
Why, sure you did. When me and Cedric rushed in there, why, that lion was just standing over you, sort of licking you in the face.
Licking me in the face?
Yes, sir, that's what he's doing.
Oh, my goodness, I'm glad I never knowed that.
Well, I believe he likes you, Lum. I think he wants to make friends with you.
Oh, no. No, no friend would ever spring on a feller in the dark that way. You get shut of that critter, Abner, and do it right away.
All right, I'm going to. But first, I'll have to find... Wait a minute. There comes Cedric up out there. He can help me get rid of the lion, I bet you.
Yeah, make him help you. He's as much to blame for my condition as anyone else, I know that.
My doggies, I wish we could keep the lion for just a few days anyway, Lum. After all, I paid Squire $150 for him out of my own pocket.
I don't care how much you paid for him. I never want to see that line or any other line as long as I live. Not even if I live to be, howdy, Cedric, 1,000 or 100 years old.
Howdy, Cedric, come
Hello,
in.
Mr. Abner. Howdy, Mr. Lum. Boy, have me and Irvin been having fun.
Irvin?
Yes, Mom, him and me's been out riding in my car.
Well, I'm glad there's still somebody able to enjoy himself. Somebody that ain't been a nervous wreck like I have.
Well, how's Irvin been behaving, Cedric?
Oh, just fine, Mr. Abner. Sets up there in the front seat with me and acts like he's tickled to death.
Well, has he bit anybody yet?
Oh, no, Mom. He's awful friendly. Just wags his tail.
Well...
His tail? For goodness sake, Cedric, what kind of friends have you got?
Friends? Oh, I reckon we forgot to tell you, Lum. Irvin's the lion.
The lion?
Sure.
Yes, Mom, I named him after my favorite uncle, Uncle Irvin.
That's what he done.
He had whiskers that looked just about like the lion's.
Well, wait a minute here, Cedric. Are you trying to tell me that you've been driving around with that ferocious lion sitting up in the front seat with you?
Yes, Mom, and everybody in town's been following us around, just like a parade. Boy.
Well.
Swan to goodness. Ain't he scratched you or bit you or nothing?
Why, no, Lum. Cedric and Irvin get along uncommonly good together. You ought to just see him.
Well, now I know we got to get shut of that line. First thing we know, he's going to turn on Cedric when he ain't looking and tear him to pieces.
Oh, I ain't scared of Irvin. I believe he sort of likes me, Mr. Lum. I can tell by the way he licks my fingers after I feed him the hamburgers.
Licks your fingers? Granny, you better count your fingers every time after he gets through doing that.
Oh, I don't have to worry none about him eating me on account of me being a Tarzan.
A Tarzan?
Yes, Mom. Leastwise, that's what Miss Fredericks said I was.
Miss Fredericks?
Yes, Mom. She called me Tarzan the Lion Tamer.
Well...
Where did you see her?
Oh, I seen her a couple of times today. Seen her first on her way to the schoolhouse this morning. I offered to give her a ride in my car, but for some reason or other, she wouldn't get in.
Well, I do know. Reckon why she wouldn't, Cedric.
I don't know. I believe she could have squeezed in beside me and Irvin all right.
Irvin? Well, no wonder you can't expect a little delicate woman like her to get in a car with a lion in it. Granny's.
Oh, she weren't exactly scared of him, Mr. Lum. Fact is, she hung around and watched him for a long time. Said I was awful brave the way I handled him.
Did she say that?
Yes, Mom.
And she called you Tarzan the Lion Tamer?
Yes, Mom. She admires lion tamers. Said she went to a circus once and spent her whole time just watching the lion tamers go into the cages with the lions and wrestle with them and do tricks with them and stuff. She said they's about the bravest men there is.
Admires lion tamers, huh? Did she actually say that?
Yes, Mom. She said maybe I could get to be a real one someday, so I showed her how I can put my hand right in his mouth.
Right inside his mouth?
Granny's, I put my head right in it. Oh, wait a minute, what am I saying?
Well, I dog is lum now, wait a minute. That might be a good idea, you know it? If you could get to be a lion tamer.
Who, me?
Why, sure. See that away, why, you'll have Miss Frederick following you and Irvin all over town.
Yeah.
And then she'll admire you when you have him do his tricks and all that stuff, you know. And then after she admires you for being brave enough to train a lion, why, and she'll fall in love with you, and you can propose to her, and maybe she'll marry you.
Yeah, Granny, that's a good idea. Wait a minute, though. How do I know I can handle a lion?
Well, now, Lum, if Cedric can handle him, why, you are, too.
Yeah, but maybe Cedric's different from me. Maybe he actually is a Tarzan, like Miss Frederick says he is.
Yes, Mom, Tarzan the Lion Tamer.
Well, what's that got to do with it, Lum?
Well, Tarzan ain't like a human, Abner.
He ain't, huh?
I know. He's a feller who growed up in the jungles and lived with animals and sort of speaks their language. That-a-way, the animals thinks he's one of them and they're sort of nice to him.
Well?
But they're liable to eat up a human like me.
Well, Cedric ain't no animal, Lum. He wears clothes like a human, and, well, a lion don't eat him up.
No, but if he was...
You ought to at least try it, Lum. I know if you make a success of yourself as a lion tamer, you can win Miss Frederick just as easy as anything.
Yeah. Cedric, are you sure Miss Frederick told you all that stuff?
Yes, Mom. Well, what else did she say? Well, she said once she went to a circus and she spent her whole time just watching
the
lion tamer.
You done told us that.
Mom?
You told us that once.
Oh.
Cedric, do you think that lion would bite my arm off if I just sort of petted him a little?
I don't know. You can try it once, Mr. Lum, and if it don't work...
Why, sure, Lum, you can try it once.
Once? Feller don't get but two tries on something like that, and then he runs out of arms. No, sir, I want to come out of this with both my arms still on anyway.
Well, of course, you don't want to do it. It's your own business, Lum. I don't reckon it makes no difference anyway, as long as we have to get shut of the lion.
Get shut of him? Who said anything about getting shut of him?
Well, didn't you say that you want me
to... Listen, Admiral, that's my line, and nobody ain't going to get shut of him or do anything else with him unless I tell them to.
Well, Lum, you told me...
And never talk back to a Tarzan.
Tarzan?
That's right. You don't know it yet, Admiral, but you may be looking at the new Pine Ridge Tarzan.
Who? You?
Yes, sir. L. Tarzan Eddards, lion tamer and head librarian.
Say, folks, be sure that you and every member of your family get enough vitamins A and D every day this winter. Protect yourself against the deficiencies caused by a shortage of these two important vitamins. Now that vitamin A and D prices are down so low, you just can't afford to take unnecessary chances. The thing you should do is take one-a-day brand vitamin A and D tablets every day. One tablet a day is all you take. And one penny a day is all it costs. Yet, even at this amazingly low price, each one-a-day vitamin tablet contains the same amount of vitamins A and D as two whole teaspoonfuls of cod liver oil, meeting minimum United States pharmacopoeia standards, enough to supply your full, normal daily need of these two important vitamins. Now, what's more, one-a-day tablets are so pleasant to taste, so convenient to take, too, because one tablet a day is all you need. You better get a package from your druggist and start getting their protective benefits today. And, by the way, when you get your one-a-day vitamin A and D tablets, ask your druggist for a package of Alka-Seltzer, too,
L. Tarzan Eddards. Oh, my goodness. Tomorrow, we'll have more comedy with Jack Benny, Phil Harris, Amos and Andy, the Old Gold Comedy Theater, and Claudia. That's coming up on our Sunday edition. Hope you enjoy our comedy weekend here, and we will see you tomorrow. Don't forget our webpage, classicradio.stream. Give us a visit, and we'll see you next time right here with more Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.